You may have heard about Glashutte Original watches.
I have.
You may have even seen or read reviews of their watches.
Of course I have.
But have you ever seen someone wearing one in public?
No, I haven't.
I've got here the Glashutte Original SeaQ with the green dial, and I really like it. This may be the best luxury dive watch you've never seen. Let me show you this watch, why I like it, and how I think it could even be better, and reasons why we don't see more of them in person on this episode of Adventures with Time. Every day we can see Rolex watches being worn. Same with Omega and many other so-called luxury or high-end watches. Then there are those luxury watches which you may never have seen on someone's wrist. H. Moser, A. Lange & Son, and Patek Philippe come to mind. But you've probably heard of these brands if you are a watch enthusiast. Heck, I even have a Patek watch in my collection. The watches from Glashutte Original fall into this cohort. Yet, even if you're a watch enthusiast, you may never have heard of Glashutte Original. I hadn't until I saw and tried one on in a watch shop a couple of years ago. So what is Glashutte Original? Or should I say, who is Glashutte Original? If you want to skip this short history lesson or any other part of this video, there are time codes in the description below, or simply use the video timeline here at the bottom of the screen. Glashutte Original is a German watchmaker, one with a long and respected history which started in 1847, more than 175 years ago. Glashutte was one of the original watchmakers that was founded in the town of Glashutte in Saxony, Germany. You can see on this map some of the many other watchmakers that are based in this area. Some are very well known. There's A. Lange & Son, which I mentioned before, and a brand you may have heard of is Nomos Glashütte. Several companies use Glashütte in their brand name. But remember, Glashütte is the name of a town. Glashütte Original is the name of a watchmaking company. Over the years, the watchmaking landscape in this area has changed, including impacts from World War II. In 1951, many of the watch companies in this area merged. After the reunification of East and West Germany in 1990, Glashütte Urban Tribe, or Glashütte Watch Operations, was commercially registered. And in 2000, Glashütte Original became part of the Mega Swatch Group. Today, Glashütte Original is known for their elegant, high-quality watches. They pride themselves on the detailed, handmade components that go into their watches. Their current line of watches is made up of five collections. The Senator is a collection of what I would call dress watches. There are 14 models in this collection, some with variations. I first became aware of the Glashütte Original brand a couple of years ago when I tried on the Senator Excellence Panorama Date Moon Phase in gold. A beautiful watch, but well out of my price range. I'll try to get another watch from this collection so I can show you it in detail. The Pano collection consists of 8 models of watches with asymmetric dials. You've probably seen this design aesthetic before. An off-centered main dial with sub-dials or complication elements outside of this main dial provide for an interesting look that is certain to draw attention on one's wrist. A. Lange & Son has watches with a similar layout. Glashütte Original's collection of iconic watches consists of both round and square dials with a classic look from the 60s and 70s, a stylish lineup, some with Arabic indices in a font that reminds me of the early space age. Not sure why. There is a collection of watches designed specifically for women. Obviously, these are smaller sized watches. All seem to have diamonds embedded in the bezel. Finally, we have the specialist collection of sports watches, specifically dive watches. There is the 39.5mm SeaQ watch, which we will look at today. They also offer a larger 43.2mm SeaQ panorama date. Other than the larger diameter, the other obvious difference is the larger date window and its placement at 4 o'clock. But unlike other 4 o'clock date windows I've seen, here the date numerals are on the horizontal rather than slanted. Glashütte has done this correctly, in my opinion. Now let's take a thorough look at the SeaQ. I specifically requested to see the green dial model. This color option is called reed green, I'm not a big fan of blue watches, and black seems so common. I wanted to see something different. Maybe I'm subconsciously trying to compare it to the Rolex Hulk. No.
No?
Maybe. The SeaQ was launched in 2019, 50 years after the 1969 launch of Glashütte's original diver's watch on which the SeaQ was inspired. The Specimatic Type RPTS200 and the Green Dial model, which I have here, was launched just a few months ago in March of 2021. Let's take a quick overview of the Glashütte Original SeaQ specifications. Diameter of 39.5 mm, thickness of 12.15 mm, lug width of 20 mm, and a lug-to-lug distance of 47 mm. Weight in the stainless steel case with its bracelet comes in at 152 grams. A nice sapphire dome box crystal with anti-reflective coating on both the outside and the underside of the crystal. We'll take a look later as to what sort of the distortions one gets off this crystal. A screw-down crown and screw-down case back offer this watch 200 meters of water resistance. 120-click unidirectional dive bezel and super luminova on the hands and indices. And the Glashütte Original in-house caliber 39-11 automatic movement with a rate of 28,800 beats per hour and a 40-hour power reserve. I'll give you my thoughts on these specifications as we look at the design, quality, and aesthetics of this watch a bit later. Okay, you want to know the price of this watch. The suggested retail of this watch, as shown, is $10,200. I've heard that one can probably get discounts from the AD, but I have not confirmed that for myself. $10,000 is well into what I call the luxury category. That is in the same price range as a Rolex Submariner Date. Of course, we know that you can't get a discount on the Subby and would be lucky even to buy one. $10,000 is under the retail price of the Blancpain 50 Fathoms Bathyscape, double the retail price of both the Omega Seamaster Diver 300 and a Tudor Pelagos, and about three times the price of my Tudor Black Bay 58. There are more price comparisons I could make, but I'll stop there. Now let's take a closer look at the SeaQ aesthetics and wearability. Let's start with look and feel on the wrist. The fit is extremely comfortable. The nicely curved lugs and flexible bracelet enable this watch to mold to one's wrist in a form-fitting manner. There is no slipping of the watch head, perhaps due to the snug fit one can get with the micro-adjustment system. More on that later. Even with a 162 gram weight, you will forget you're wearing this watch due to the relaxed and yet secure fit. But look down and get a glimpse at that beautiful dial and you'll be reminded that you're wearing a very attractive watch. One that others are sure to notice. This watch has a clean and refined look, yet one that conveys quality, owed I think mostly to the dial. So let's survey that dial. Fitting into a nicely finished case that, from the side, looks thinner than its measurements, the vertical brushing and chamfered edge that meets the bezel gives the impression of a thinner case, helped by the angled ceramic bezel insert and the ever-so-slightly domed crystal that might be called box, but with an angled edge rather than the more sharp corners associated with a box crystal. I guess we can still call it box, right? This creates some interesting distortions at certain angles. Although I don't normally measure the dimensions of watch crowns, it appeared to me that the SeaQ has a longer crown than other watches, which provides for a secure grip. And note the double G logo on the crown as found on the case back and bracelet clasp. The SeaQ has a screw-down case back with engravings in the form of a trident, the Glashütte Original double G, and 20 waves, which symbolize the 20 bar water resistance of this watch. Note that there is a serial number on the case back. I like that dark green dial with its matte finish, which the brand calls lacquered. Very clean with bold applied indices filled with super luminova, Arabic numerals at the even hours, and rectangles for the rest. Looking at the line of SeaQ models, you might note that the black dial has painted indices to be true to the original 1969 Spezimatic Type RP TS200. The other dial color models have these applied indices to emphasize the stainless steel case material. I think they add a modern aesthetic to the dial rather than the flat look of the retro style painted indices. Obelisk cans with a large arrow on the minute hand and a lollipop second hand with a teardrop counterbalance. That second hand goes all the way to and past that second track. Finally, a date window at the 3 o'clock position, which has a beveled edge with white trim to help balance the symmetry of the watch face. Truly a dial that meets the legibility needs of a sports watch and the refinement of a dress watch. Perfect for a casual daily wear watch that I like to have in my collection. I get the same feeling about the SeaQ as I do with my Tudor Black Bay 58. In fact, in many ways, they are very similar watches in look and feel. I do have a watch style, don't I? When it comes to quality, I don't think you can surpass what Glashütte Original has done with the SeaQ. The finish, from everything I've seen, is top-notch. Clean vertical brushing on the sides and a circular brushing on the case top with a sharp polished chamfer between the two. Sharp printing on the dial, and of course, everything lines up. I know you all want to know how the bezel action is. Well, it's one of the crispest bezels I've seen. Nice clicking action with no movement once it lands in position. If ordered on the bracelet, you get one of the nicest and highly refined bracelets I've seen. There's virtually no space between the lugs and the bracelet end links. No wiggle at all. Each link is composed of three pieces, a polished centerpiece, and two brushed M caps. Nice movement in those links, yet look how straight it stays when turned on its side. You won't find any push pins or screws on the sides of these links. So how does one size the bracelet? Look at the underside of the bracelet. Each end cap has two things that look like screws, but they are not screws. They are eccentrics, something like clasps that hold the pins in place. Note they are all aligned, pointing towards the case. Turning the eccentrics counterclockwise a quarter turn unlocks the pin so that you can wiggle the end cap and pins out. When replacing them in the bracelet, one turns the eccentrics counterclockwise to lock them back in place. How about that for fine engineering? But wait, there's more! Built into the clasp is a micro-ratcheted system. No pins involved here. Simply press the hidden button under the double G on the clasp to release the ratchet and loosen the bracelet. To tighten, you just push the bracelet in as much as needed. Look at the machining of this mechanism on the underside. Beautiful. Beyond the observable elements of quality, the SeaQ is tested to both the German DIN 8306 and the ISO 6424 standards and features for divers watches. These include visibility under total darkness and magnetic shock and chemical resistance. The watch undergoes 24 days of testing, covering condensation under extreme temperature changes, low and high pressure extremes, and accuracy under everyday rotation usage. The movement in the SeaQ is beautifully finished with a skeletonized rotor, swan neck fine adjustment, and lots of fine finishing to the components. By now, you've probably surmised that I'm a huge fan of the SeaQ. Well, more than a fan, I'd like to have this watch in my collection. Unfortunately, I'm not currently able to afford it. Not that there aren't things I'd like to change on the SeaQ, but not much. I don't understand why they don't have a display case back on this watch. The caliber 3911 movement is so beautifully finished. I want to be able to see it. I've asked the brand why the SeaQ doesn't have a display case back, as does the larger SeaQ panel model. I was told they wanted to use the case back engraving with 20 ways to represent this watch's 20 bar water resistance. I, for one, would have preferred a display back. I'm hoping to get the panel in for review so we can take a live look at its movement. So stay tuned. Some have complained that the caliber 3911 has only a 40-hour power reserve. From simply a spec point of view, yeah, it could be more. But for practical use, 40 hours is sufficient for me. If you're not wearing this watch for a day and a half, 36 hours, you're probably not going to wear it for 3 days, 72 hours. So movement with a longer power reserve would not do you any good. I'm not sure how easily the power center links will scratch. But hey, we shouldn't worry about that. It shows you've used the watch. Plus, scratches can be polished out of those center links. Why do I like this watch so much? Glashutte Original is a great brand with a long and prominent history. A brand known by those familiar with it as a maker of quality watches. One that performs virtually all their work in-house. For me, it goes beyond the brand. I like watches that fit into my casual lifestyle, yet ones that have a bit of interest to them. The SeaQ matches perfectly with that criteria, as do many dive watches, since they have a timing bezel that adds life to the look. The applied indices and beveled edges to the case and crystal edge provide just enough light reflection to give animation to this watch. All of these aesthetics and outstanding engineering and meticulous finishing makes the SeaQ a watch that is hard to beat. So, like several watch enthusiasts have said, if this is such a great watch, why aren't they owned and worn by more people? As I've said in the opening, you probably have never seen a Glashutte Original watch being worn in public. I think it comes down to a couple of points. It's tough to buy a luxury watch. Or should I say, buy a $10,000 watch. Glashutte Original is not a name brand like Rolex or Omega, even if the SeaQ definitely stacks up to these better known brands. One worries about the value retention in case you later lose interest or some other circumstances forces you to sell the watch. From what I can tell, watches from Glashutte Original do not increase in value. Do any of you have experience in this area? Let us know. Someone looking for wrist candy, that is, something that will be recognized on their wrist as an expensive watch, will probably not go for a SeaQ. Few, if anyone, will look at your wrist and be impressed that you have this watch unless they are familiar with the brand and its products. For me, as a watch enthusiast, that shouldn't matter. I should and would be happy to have a beautiful watch made to high quality standards. I shouldn't care about the aftermarket value of any purchase I make. In fact, I should pride myself on the fact that I have such a watch that the general public doesn't know nor cares about. It's so much more to me than having a status symbol. It's the feeling I get from finding a beautiful watch that I like and knowing that it's made to some of the highest levels of quality. What's your thoughts about the SeaQ? Did you know about Glashutte Original before this video? Let us know in the comments below. Here's a video of my Tudor Black Bay 58, and here is my State of the Collection video from earlier this year. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in my next video.